thank you, God. Yes. Hey, yes. God, hallelujah, in Jesus. Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
Amen.
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 Amen. Well, the word for today is encourage yourself in the Lord. Your family.
pray. I feel like it. My voice might not portray, but oh, you learn how to pray. As you worship the Lord. And you know how to pray. Those are your weapons.
Come on. That's right. Come on.
Do not speak gloom, doom, and defeat.
Come on.
But speak encouragement to yourself.
Right.
I will bless the Lord. I'll magnify Him. His praise shall continue to be in my mouth. You got to speak to yourself.
Come on to it. That's it. Yes.
See, think. You got to take that word.
Yes.
And as you begin to praise God, praise and worship communes you with God. The Bible says that the joy of the Lord is my strength. Y'all believe why He was singing those songs? Oh, magnify the Lord. I believe there's joy began to spring up in the song. I believe the Bible said joy is my strength. So therefore the joy of the Lord now encouraged him. See, joy is coming. Heaven is coming though. I feel like this today. I feel like that tomorrow. But joy is ever present.
Sometimes you just and that we're in our right minds. Let's praise God today. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah.
That's all right.
Hallelujah. Amen. able to do it. No, in and of yourself, you can't do certain things.
Yes.
But you have to rely on the power of God. Your God owns the cattle on a thousand hills.
Yes. 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 Yes.
He's able.
He's able.
He's able. He's able. You ask. It says ask and it shall be given. It says you have not because you asked not. And sometimes we get discouraged because we don't ask. The reason we didn't ask is because we're afraid of the answer. Because most of the time when we ask, God says yes, but. And he'll have some type of responsibility to put on us in order to have that which we have asked for. And that's the reason we stay quiet on stuff sometimes. We don't want to ask because then we will get the answer, yes, but I need you to do this, that, and the other. We don't want to be accountable to the this, that, and the other. But you have not because you ask not. I dare you to ask God.
Yes.
I dare you to ask him. And then follow what he tells you to do.
Yes.
Your God is able.
Yes.
He's able.
Yes.
Exceedingly abundantly above anything you could ever think or ask.
Yes.
He's able.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Come on, let's give God some praise. If you stand with me, James 1, we're going to the first chapter of James, and I'm going to read the 22nd through the 25th verse. James chapter 1, 22 through 25. And it reads, "But be doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man observing his natural face in a mirror. For he observes himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this one will be blessed in what he does."
Yes.
May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. You may have your seats. Today's message will be brief, and it is entitled, "The Dabblers and the Divers."
Okay.
Erica and I live on a man-made water hole, like a little like lake type thing in our backyard. And around that water hole, we have ducks. And you can learn a lot from the study of the duck. And from what Erica actually told me about this, but I looked it up and did further research, and there are over 130 different species of duck around the world. Did y'all know that?
Nope.
I thought maybe there were 10 or 15 different types, but there are over 130 different kinds. And of the 130, they are most commonly broken down into two specific categories. And those categories are the dabblers and the divers.
Okay. Uh-huh.
You can tell a diver duck from a dabbler duck by the way it walks. A dabbler has legs that are located toward the center of their body. And so the legs make it easier to walk on the land. And because these are the ducks that feed on the vegetation, and they feed on the things that are closest to the surface of the water. They don't go into the depths of the water. The dabbler ducks, the way that they eat is basically they just stick their heads in just enough to get whatever's floating around the top, or they'll eat the vegetation or the seeds around the lake, but they don't ever get down deep into the lake. Now, the diver duck, you can find them and you can notice them because they have a hard time walking on the land. Their legs are located closer to their tail feathers, and so they're more upright when they walk, and they're more off balance because the legs aren't centered under them, they're centered behind them. And so they have a hard time walking on land, but the legs are good for the diving because these animals feed from the stuff that's deep down in the lake. Now, how many people know that the stuff that surfaces is the stuff that you really don't want to eat? Anybody ever seen the top of a lake? The algae and like the really, really small fish bugs and all that. That's what's on top of the lake.
Right.
But the stuff at the depths of the lake, that's the stuff we eat.
Uh-huh.
If you fish in the right pond, I mean, you get trout and bass and all kinds of good stuff from inside the lake. And so these are the ducks, the diver ducks, they feed on the stuff with the real good nutrition.
Right.
And they're able to do that because of the way that their legs are positioned. You can tell a diver duck because it is able to swim underneath the water. And even when it is on, and check this out, when it is on the water, it even sits lower in the water, because when it's on the water, it sucks in all of the air from its feathers, so it is already in position to dive. And so therefore, if it sees, and it's already shrunk itself into the water, if it sees something that it wants, because it already has gotten in position for diving, it doesn't have to go through a whole lot to get underneath the water. Unlike the dabbler duck, who will sit high on the water because it's never going to do anything more than put its head in and come right back up, who's more comfortable on dry land. Unlike the dabbler duck, who will just put its beak in and get a little something off the top, the diver duck is ready and has prepared itself to go deep into the water. Now, when Christians are hearers of the word only, they're like the dabbler ducks. Walking in the world is easy for the dabbler duck. Walking in the world is easy for the dabbler Christian. See, you got to understand something. When you a dabbler Christian and all you get is the surface stuff, and you don't really get deep into it, all you got is the surface. Well, walking in the world real easy, because you ain't got nothing to hold you down from wanting to walk and discourage you from wanting to walk in the world. For the diver duck, though, for the diver Christian, the diver Christian is one who is not just a hearer of the word, but a doer of the word. The dabbler is the one that gets the spiritual crumbs, the leftovers, the things that those of us that have dived in and gotten the stuff that we don't want anymore. But the diver is the one that gets down deep into the word, that surrounds itself by the word. The diver Christian is the one that literally engrosses itself and will engage and put itself so deep into the word that it cannot live comfortably outside of the word, but will live, can't live in, on the word, on the land, and will have a problem navigating itself on the land. How many people know that I want to be a diver because I'm not built for that? Me.
Uh-huh.
We have come into a season now more than ever that we must be doers of the word. And what good is the word if we are not applying it? Some of us know the word but have yet to apply the word.
Right.
You know, when I was a little girl, I had a tendency to fall down, scrape my knees and all that kind of stuff very often. I was very, very active as a kid. I was very adventurous. I still am. I love to climb trees. Erica can tell you I'll do a combat roll. If I didn't think, you know, she'd be embarrassed, I'd do one right here for you. You know, I love stuff like that. I mean, that's just me. I'll climb up to this ceiling and rappel down if you let me. But in any case, I was had been like that since I was a child. But as a child, doing stuff like that, I hurt myself a lot. I used to scrape my knees up, and you can still see the scars, my legs and everything. My aunt used to be like, "You ain't never gonna be no model with no legs looking like that." I'm like, "Well, I don't wanna be no model." You know, so I tore myself up, but my grandmother used to always, how many people have one of them grandmas that had that Vaseline bottle?
Okay.
Yes. Vaseline cure everything, though. When you scrape a knee, boy, she scoops some of that Vaseline out and she put it on there. That was our salve. I ain't know nothing about no salve, no real salve. Vaseline was salve. And so every time I'd fall down, my grandmother would come and she'd come with a little thing to disinfect it, and she'll take some of that Vaseline and wipe it on there, and I was good to go get another scrape or scratch, you know. But the thing is, what if we just had the Vaseline bottle in the cabinet, and when I scraped my knee, we never applied it? just good enough to have it in the house, you
right,
see.
Right.
And so would my scrape have healed, or would it have protected me from the counter or from the cupboard?
No.
In order for it to protect the scrape, she had to take it out of the cupboard and apply it to my knee or leg or arm or whatever I had hurt for that day. The same thing applies to the word. Many of us know the word. We got Bibles, they sitting on our shelf, and some of us even take those Bibles down every now and then and blow them off and read through them a few times.
Uh-huh.
Right?
Uh-huh.
But if you never apply what you have read to your life, it's just like having a Vaseline bottle sitting in your cabinet, scrape your knee and never put it on. Just say, well, it's there, it's good enough, right? It's good enough that I read it, isn't it? It's good enough that I have a Bible, isn't it? No, you got to apply the word. Some of us have not gotten into the habit of finding the applicable portions of the word and placing them onto our lives so that it is like a salve, so that it begins to heal the places of our lives that have been broken, that need mending, those places in our lives that we need God's word to fill in, those places in our lives that we need God's word to penetrate. We have yet to take it out of the cover. We have yet to apply it to our lives. And I'm going to teach you today, it's real simple, on how do I apply the word of God for myself. Because that's what I mean about being more than a hearer, but also a doer of the word. Faith comes by hearing.
Yes.
And hearing the word of God. That is the truth. You've got to hear it first. And if you don't hear it from me or somebody else, you got to hear it from your own mind. So reading the word and getting the word is nothing more than the first step.
Yes.
That's the first step. But some of us don't go any further than that. We do the first step, and that's wonderful. That's good. Don't stop doing the first step, because that's the number one step. And that's a very important step. But to really ingest the word, that means that you must be learning the word for the intended purpose of applying it. When you read it, you have to be thinking about, now how can this be applied to my life?
That's right.
Oftentimes we read the Bible thinking that it was written for someone else.
Right.
We read it like it's not meant for us.
Right.
But that we believe that it's for them over there, or since it's so old that it's written for those people that lived so long ago.
Right.
But the thing is, the word of God is living, breathing, and active.
Right. Yes.
Which means that I don't care how old it is or how old it becomes, there are still portions in it that are pertinent to your life today. And that's what makes it such an amazing piece of literature, because of the fact that God's spirit literally rests and rules and abides in it, so that it is alive, because it will be able to be like a salve onto your life even now today.
That's right.
If you allow it.
That's right.
If you let it. If you let it. That means when you read it and it says, no weapon formed against you shall prosper,
right,
that means that you need to believe that no weapon formed against
that's
you
right
shall prosper.
Right.
That
yeah
means that you should not get discouraged or fearful or blown out of your mind when somebody decides to make a weapon against you.
Right.
See, that shouldn't scare you, because that should bring back to remembrance of your mind what the Bible says, no weapon formed against me will prosper. So when I see you making a weapon, I don't do anything but sit there and laugh. Oh, you think you're making a weapon, don't you? Oh, you're making it and forming it against me? Okay, good to go. Because my Bible said, and I read it and I believe it to be so, that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. So I'm going to sit right there, arms folded. Matter of fact, I'm just going to stand right over you and let you make the weapon, because I want you to try to use it, because the Bible told me that if you try to use it, it's not going to work. Amen. And so I'll stand there and I'll smile at you all the while you're creating, because I believe what the word of God says. That's me applying the word of God to my situation. When it says that you are more than a conqueror, believe it. Many of us, we go through life and we say it and we know that scripture, I'm more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ. We know it, don't we? And we go through life until we reach opposition. And then it stops us dead in our tracks. And all of a sudden, we ain't conquerors no more.
Right, right, right.
All of a sudden, we forget the verse just leaves and opposition. We reach something that we should be conquering. How many people know you ain't a conqueror until you conquer something? There's got to be something in your way for you to conquer in order for you to proclaim that you are a conqueror. So us saying the verse, I'm more than a conqueror through Jesus Christ, that's nothing. God is going to say, okay, good to go, because let me give you something to conquer. Giants and overcome and defeat the enemy, you got to know that you can do those things. But you also have to pay attention to some of the other things as well. When it tells you to love your enemies, you got to love them. When it says to pray for your enemies and those that persecute you, you got to pray. See, that's what it means by being a diver. That's what it means by being a doer of the word. Because that means that we take the good and the things that empower us, and we can conquer anything, or we can do anything, and I'm strong and I'm courageous, and God is with me. Goodness and mercy are right behind me. It says they're following me all the days of my life, and I feel like I can do anything. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'm not afraid. I'll fear no evil, for thou art with me. And we got to take all of that, but at the same time, we got to do what the word says. Right. When it comes to some of the stuff that we don't really want to do. How many people know that we have come upon a time now where our enemies have taken off their mask?
Yeah.
And they're smiling directly in our faces and showing us exactly who they are.
Yes.
We have come into a season of boldness.
Yes.
Yes, we have. We have come into a season of, they're getting bolder and bolder. The people that used to be a couple years ago that you didn't know who your enemies were. Because they hid. It wasn't a cool thing to be an enemy. So they hid and you didn't know who they were. But you know what? I can't say I despise this time. Because I love to see people without the mask.
Exactly.
I want to see who you are.
Right.
So that I can identify you. Because now I know who to stay away from. Now I know how to act. You know, when they said, well, we need to ban the Confederate flag, I said, well, how am I going to know which establishment's not to go into now?
Exactly.
You know, and not to say that I'm for the Confederate flag on government buildings. Believe me, I'm not. But they started taking the Confederate flag off of everything. Do that, because that's how I know to stay away from folks and stay away from places. If the Confederate flag is flying, I ain't going into that shop. We going now, we need some gas, but I see the Confederate flag, I'm gonna pass by that one and go on to the next one, because they don't take too kindly. Chances are they don't take too kindly to people like me. So, you know, how am I supposed to distinguish between the ones that I want to be around and the ones that won't be around? So I'm happy, a little bit happy. I can't say I'm ecstatic, but I see a silver lining in the cloud that there are people now that are taking off the mask, and people that you've known for years upon years now are showing you exactly who they are, especially on Facebook.
Yeah.
Woo.
Yeah.
Oh, because they fearless on Facebook, boy. They won't say stuff to your face in person, but they sure will put it on Facebook. And so now we are beginning to see these people for who they really are, and we are beginning to know what's really in their minds. And God has now said to us, and this is where it becomes hard, that we are supposed to love those people and also pray for them. And if we are going to be divers in the word, if we are going to be doers of the word, we got to do it. But I promise you that there is a blessing. There's a blessing in the doing. The Bible already said it. It said it here. It said that, but he who looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues in it and is not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the word, this one will be blessed in what he does. Yeah. And so when we pray for people that we don't like or that don't like us, and when we pray for those that are persecuting us, and when we turn the other cheek. And let me explain turn the other cheek real quick. You know, we oftentimes we feel like Jesus was saying that we should allow them to slap us once, then turn the other cheek and let them do it again, and then I guess that can go on and on, turn it again, do it again. Let me explain to you what that really meant, and then I'm about to get up out of here. And I'm gonna explain it to you like this. How many of y'all, and maybe you can relate to me, if I got enough people in here, I'll tell it like this. How many of y'all got spanked when you was kids? Okay, because I don't know, I'm in the new age now. Folks say, don't hit kids. You know, but I came from a household that they believed in the rod. We believed in, you know, my grandma would wear me out in a heartbeat if I was out of line. And so I didn't have to get too many of them before I learned. But let me just explain it to you like this. Now, what would have happened if your grandma, mama, auntie, father, granddaddy, whoever used to give you your licks, what would have happened if when they got you and you know, they use a belt, a chancla or a extension cord or whatever they had, they hand, you know, whatever it was. My grandma used to have a floss water, boy, yes, and before me she had a switch from my mom and my aunt, but the switch had broke by the time I came along, so she didn't feel like going to get another. She got a floss water, an old metal one. And so, buddy. So she got me, chap. What would have happened if when she got me, I turned around, looked at her, and said, well, get this one too. What would have happened if I would have did that? If she would have got me on this side, and I turned around and said, all right, well, get that side too then. You into hitting, so let's go hit. Because back in Jesus' day, that's exactly what Jesus was saying. When they slap you and you turn the other cheek in order to say, come on, hit me like a man, because that wasn't nothing. I didn't even feel that one. Yeah. That's what he was saying. He wasn't saying be a pushover. He wasn't saying allow people to slap you and then, oh, woe is me, I'm slapped, so let me turn and you can do it again if you want, but look at old Poe Pitiful Me. Don't you not want to slap me? You would hit somebody with glasses, would you? You know, he's not saying to do that. He's saying to be a bigger person and say, listen here, what you just said, as hard as you think you just hit me, that wasn't nothing. I didn't even feel. Y'all remember Della Reese when, I'm a doer of the word. The Bible said I'm going to be blessed because if I do these things, there's a blessing in it for me.
Yes.
So I refuse to lie down for the enemy.
Right.
I refuse to do what they want me to do, which is to sit there and to trade blows with them. And that's what the enemy wants. The enemy wants to hit you and you hit them back.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Right.
But guess what? You hit me, but it ain't even hurt. Come on.
Right.
Come on.
Right.
It's time that we be doers of the word, Agape. And the word has so much to say. I can't go through it all because today, right now. But it has so much to say. There are promises in the word. There's blessings in the word. There are commandments in the word. There's things that God, Jesus said to love your neighbor as yourself. That's something that we should be applying to our lives. God said that we should not worry. We should be applying that.
Yeah.
That's it.
To our lives. I encourage you to, number one, get in that word and see what your promises and what your blessings and what your commands are. You can't apply something that you don't know exists.
That's it. Right.
Find out what God has for you. And then apply it. How is this applicable to me? How is this applicable to my life? What do I need to do? How is this convicting my life? The word should convict you. When you read it, you should feel convicted in certain areas. Oh, wow. I didn't know I was supposed to be doing that. Ooh, okay. All right. I'm going to need your help on this, though, God. It should convict you. It should convict you. Certain things should empower you. Certain things should give you hope. See, it's so living and active that it should do certain things for you at certain times. Certain stuff should chastise you.
That's right.
Everything ain't going to be just glorious and happy and butterflies. Some of it is. Some of it should make you happy. Some of it should give you joy. Some of it should make you feel that you can do anything, that you're on top of the world. Some of it should let you know just how small you are and how you need God. You should go through the ups and the downs just like life is through the word of God.
Amen.
So that you apply every ounce of it. And the more you apply, the better and the more blessed you will become. It is God's literal prescription for our lives. Who created you? Who created this earth? God. So he knows the ins and the outs. Don't be like me when it comes to learning how to use a cell phone and don't open up the manual. That's how I am. Right? You give me a new cell phone, I'm gonna figure it out. I'll just figure it out. I'll just do whatever. You know, it's got the function of downloading some stuff. Eric's always getting on me. Candace, you ain't know your phone had the ability to do this, that, and the other. No. Did you read the manual?
No.
No. Well, your phone can do this, that, and the other. Your phone better than my phone. You ain't even utilized. We need to train. You know. That's how she talks. Don't be like me when it comes to the cell phone with your life. See, because there is an instruction manual that God has given you to navigate this world. You fit right in. Oh, you didn't know you had the ability to do that? No. Well, you got the ability to slay giants in your life. Why haven't you done it yet? I didn't know I could. Did you read the manual? No. Don't be like that. You got the ability to heal your body. Why haven't you healed yourself yet?
Okay.
I didn't know I could. It's written in the word. Oh, did you read it?
No.
Well, you got the ability to do whatever. You know, we got all these to raise the dead. So Jesus said, greater things will you do than I did. But we won't know how to do those things unless we read the manual. You better read that manual. Know what you can do. Know what God can do in you. It's there. You just got to know how to apply it. Amen.
Amen. Amen.